Quarterback Drew Brees is condemning his own words one day after he made comments about NFL players kneeling during the national anthem. And before you hear Brees' apology, let's play what the Saints player told Yahoo Finance on Wednesday.
I will never agree with anybody disrespecting the flag of the United States of America or our country. Let me just tell you what I see or what I feel when the national anthem is played and when I look at the flag of the United States. I envision my two grandfathers who fought for this country during World War II, one in the Army and one in the Marine Corps, both risking their lives to protect our country and to try to make our country and this world a better place.
Now, Brees posted his regrets today, saying in part, quote, "In an attempt to talk about respect, unity, and solidarity centered around the American flag and the national anthem, I made comments that were insensitive and completely missed the mark on the issues we are facing right now as a country. They lacked awareness and any type of compassion or empathy. Instead, those words have become divisive and hurtful and have misled people into believing that somehow I am an enemy. This could not be further from the truth and is not an accurate reflection of my heart or my character." Let's talk about all of this with Jemele Hill. She is a sports journalist. You probably know her, and contributing writer at The Atlantic. And she also hosts the Jemele Hill is Unbothered podcast on Spotify, which you should definitely check out. Jemele, thanks for being with us. I wonder what you think of what Brees said and his apology.
So Drew Brees, unfortunately, was guilty of what too many African-Americans, too many black people, period, often hear from white people, is that when we were talking about our experiences, he immediately centered himself as if, for one, he's the only person who is engaging in this conversation who has had family members that have served in the military. One of the first things Colin Kaepernick said was that he also had friends and family who served, and maybe Drew Brees wasn't up on the history of why Colin Kaepernick chose to kneel. As opposed to showing some other form of protest, he chose to kneel because an Army Ranger, a Green Beret, excuse me, named Nate Boyer, told him that when you take a knee, it's a sign of respect for the fallen. And so maybe Drew Brees didn't understand what the connection was, but we've had three or more years to find out and understand what Colin Kaepernick's protest was really about. So the backlash that he received was from people who felt like he took what is a very trying experience of being black in America, and he made it about himself rather than what the issue is about, which is police brutality. For his apology, I mean, I guess I'm not sure if credit or being commended if that's what he exactly deserved. He needed to apologize for sure, but I'd like to see what Drew Brees does from here on out. Because look, as the old adage goes, pay attention to what they do, not to what they say.
I want you to watch a clip from Fox commentator Laura Ingraham. She's talking about NBA star LeBron James speaking up on politics, and then she talks about Drew Brees.
It's always unwise to seek political advice from someone who gets paid $100 million a year to bounce a ball. Oh, and LeBron and Kevin, you're great players, but no one voted for you. Millions elected Trump to be their coach. So keep the political commentary to yourself, or as someone once said, shut up and dribble.
Well, he's allowed to have his view about what kneeling and the flag means to him. I mean, he's a person. He has some worth, I would imagine. I mean, this is beyond football, though. This is totalitarian conduct. This is Stalinist. And by the way, on the streets of New Orleans, we're looking at live pictures. They're shouting F Drew Brees.
Wow.
That's what this moment has done to the beautiful team spirit of the New Orleans
this
Saints.
He's a great Christian man.
I don't know, Jemele, if you could find a better example of what a black athlete faces when they speak up and use their voice versus what a white athlete faces when they do.
Well, first of all, let me thank Laura Ingraham because she said shut up and dribble, I got another check because I was the narrator in the documentary that wound up being produced based off her comments that were about how through the history of movements, black athletes have always been told to, quote, shut up and dribble. So thank you, Laura. I appreciated the extra check. But yeah, you showed the hypocrisy right there. And it's not just black athletes, it's black people, period. You know, all those people when Colin Kaepernick was protesting who said, this is not the time, this is not the method, we don't like this. And then now you see people who are frustrated, all this unrest and rebellion across the country, then is we don't like this. So when do you like it? So I would like all those people who have an issue when black athletes speak out or black people speak out or when we protest, please tell us the date, the time, how you would like us to protest, how you would like us to speak to issues that are important to us in a manner in which you feel comfortable. Because clearly, Laura Ingraham is more comfortable with one athlete or one or a certain type of athlete speaking out versus another. I don't see the difference, but clearly she does, and I would love to know what that difference is. I think I can guess, though.
I would love to know as well, Jamel. The coach of the Denver Broncos had said that there's no racism, there's no discrimination in the NFL. He has spoken out for that and apologized. It's worth pointing out that there are no white owners, right? Most of the coaches are also white. Some teams have threatened to bench players if they kneeled. You wrote a column saying that the NFL has amnesia. Tell us why.
Okay, and I think you meant there are no black owners.
There are no black owners, yeah.
Correct. Yeah, the NFL, to me, for them to kind of enter into this conversation about racial inequality is interesting because they're a really great reflection of that inequality. You have a 32-team league, 3 black head coaches, only 2 black general managers, never been a black owner. So for this coach, for Vic Fangio to say that he doesn't see racism, either he's got a really big blind spot or he just doesn't want to see it because it makes him uncomfortable. And again, what we're seeing in real time are examples of the type of resistance, conversation, what is the cumulative effect of feeling like you're talking to a brick wall if you're black trying to explain what is our experience in this country. The NFL, because you theoretically have a meritocracy, given that, yes, the best player does play, but don't act as if the NFL has somehow impervious to many of the racial prejudices and biases. This is the same league where it took a really long time for black quarterbacks to be able to play because there was an assumed notion that black quarterbacks could not lead other men and they were not intellectually capable of playing the position. That was a real thing. So for him to say that is just disgraceful. And so when I wrote the column for The Atlantic, it was about this league continuing to practice selective amnesia when it came to their own racial track record.
And I think a lot of people, Jamel, don't realize that. And that's why reading your column is so important. Thank you so much for writing it. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us here on CNN. Jamel Hill, we appreciate it.
Thank you.